Section 3 of Celebrated Crimes, Volume 8, Part 1. The Marquise de Brinvilliers by Alexandre Dumas. Translated by George Burnham Ives. Section 3. The Sergeant Clouet deposed that, observing a lackey to Monsieur d'Aubray, the councillor, to be the man Lachaussee, whom he had seen in the service of Saint Croix, he said to the Marquise that if her brother knew that Lachaussee had been with Saint Croix, he would not like it. But that, Madame de Brinvilliers exclaimed,
"Dear me, don't tell my brothers, they would give him a thrashing, no doubt, and he may just as well get his wages as anybody else."
He said nothing to the d'Aubrays, though he saw Lachaussee paying daily visits to Saint Croix and to the Marquise, who was worrying Saint Croix to let her have her box, and wanted her bill for 2 or 3,000 pistoles. Otherwise, she would have had him assassinated. She often said that she was very anxious that no one should see the contents of the box, that it was a very important matter, but only concerned herself. After the box was opened, the witness added, he had told the Marquise that the commissary Picard said to Lachaussee that there were strange things in it, but the lady blushed and changed the subject. He asked her if she were not an accomplice. She said,
"What? I?"
But then muttered to herself,
"Lachaussee ought to be sent off to Picardy."
The witness repeated that she had been after Saint Croix a long time about the box, and if she had got it, she would have cut his throat. This witness further said that when he told Briancourt that Lachaussee was taken and would doubtless confess all, Briancourt, speaking of the Marquise, remarked,
"She is a lost woman."
That d'Aubray's daughter had called Briancourt a rogue, but Briancourt had replied that she little knew what obligations she was under to him, that they had wanted to poison both her and the lieutenant's widow, and he alone had hindered it. He had heard from Briancourt that the Marquise had often said that there are means to get rid of people one dislikes, and they can easily be put an end to in a bowl of soup. The girl, Edme Huet, a woman of Brescia, deposed that Saint Croix went to see the Marquise every day, and that in a box belonging to that lady she had seen two little packets containing sublimate in powder and in paste. She recognized these because she was an apothecary's daughter. She added that one day Madame de Brinvilliers, after a dinner party in a merry mood, said, showing her a little box,
"Here is vengeance on one's enemies. This box is small but holds plenty of successions."
That she gave back the box into her hands, but soon changing from her sprightly mood, she cried,
"Good heavens, what have I said? Tell nobody."
That Lambert, clerk at the palace, told her he had brought the packets to Madame from Saint Croix, that Lachaussee often went to see her, and that she herself, not being paid 10 pistoles, which the Marquise owed her, went to complain to Saint Croix, threatening to tell the lieutenant what she had seen, and accordingly the 10 pistoles were paid. Further, that the Marquise and Saint Croix always kept poison about them to make use of in case of being arrested. Laurent Paret, living with the glazier, said that he had often seen a lady call on his mistress with Saint Croix, that the footman told him she was the Marquise de Brinvilliers, that he would wager his head on it that they came to glazers to make poison, that when they came they used to leave their carriage at the Foire Saint-Germain. Marie de Villeray, maid to the Marquise, deposed that after the death of Monsieur d'Aubray, the councillor Lachaussee came to see the lady and spoke with her in private, that Briancourt said she had caused the death of a worthy man, that Briancourt every day took some electuary for fear of being poisoned, and it was no doubt due to this precaution that he was still alive. But he feared he would be stabbed because she had told him the secret about the poisoning, that d'Aubray's daughter had to be warned, and that there was a similar design against the tutor of Monsieur de Brinvilliers' children. Marie de Villeray added that 2 days after the death of the councillor, when Lachaussee was in Madame's bedroom, Couste, the late lieutenant's secretary, was announced, and Lachaussee had to be hidden in the alcove by the bed. Lachaussee brought the Marquise a letter from Saint Croix. François de Grey, officer, deposed that when he was given the king's orders, he arrested the Marquise at Liege, that he found under her bed a box which he sealed, that the lady had demanded a paper which was in it containing her confession, but he refused it, that on the road to Paris the marquise had told him that she believed it was Glazer who made the poisons for Saint Croix, that Saint Croix, who had made a rendezvous with her one day at the Cross Saint Honore, there showed her four little bottles, saying,
"See what Glazer has sent me."
She asked him for one, but Saint Croix said he would rather die than give it up. He added that the archer Antoine Barbier had given him three letters written by the Marquise de Terrier, that in the first she had told him to come at once and snatch her from the hands of the soldiers, that in the second she said that the escort was only composed of 8 persons who could be worsted by 5 men, that in the third she said that if he could not save her from the men who were taking her away, he should at least approach the commissary, and killing his valet's horse and 2 other horses in his carriage, then take the box and burn it. Otherwise she was lost. La Violetta, an archer, deposed that on the evening of the arrest, the marquise had a long pin and tried to put it in her mouth, that he stopped her and told her that she was very wicked, that he perceived that people said the truth, and that she had poisoned all her family, to which she replied that if she had, it was only through following bad advice, and that one could not always be good. Antoine Barbier, an archer, said that the marquise at table took up a glass as though to drink, and tried to swallow a piece of it, that he prevented this, and she promised to make his fortune if only he would save her, that she wrote several letters to Terrier, that during the whole journey she tried all she could to swallow pins, bits of glass, and earth, that she had proposed that he should cut de Grey's throat and kill the commissary's valet, that she had bidden him get the box and burn it, and bring a lighted torch to burn everything, that she had written to Penautier from the conciergerie, that she gave him the letter and he pretended to deliver it. Finally, Françoise Roussel deposed that she had been in the service of the marquise, and the lady had one day given her some preserved gooseberries, that she had eaten some on the point of her knife, and at once fell ill. She also gave her a slice of mutton, rather wet, which she ate, afterwards suffering great pain in the stomach, feeling as though she had been pricked in the heart, and for 3 years had felt the same, believing herself poisoned. It was difficult to continue a system of absolute denial in face of proofs like these. The marquise persisted all the same that she was in no way guilty, and Maitre Nivelle, one of her best lawyers of the period, consented to defend her cause. He combated one charge after another in a remarkably clever way, owning to the adulterous connection of the marquise with Saint Croix, but denying her participation in the murders of the d'Aubrays, father and sons. These he ascribed entirely to the vengeance desired by Saint Croix. As to the confession, the strongest and, he maintained, the only evidence against Madame de Brinvilliers, he attacked its validity by bringing forward certain similar cases where the evidence supplied by the accused against themselves had not been admitted by reason of the legal action. Non auditor perie volens. He cited 3 instances, and as they are themselves interesting, we copy them verbatim from his notes. First case. Domenico Sotto, a very famous canonist and theologian, confessor to Charles V, present at the first meetings of the Council of Trent under Paul III, propounds a question about a man who had lost a paper on which he had written down his sins. It happened that this paper fell into the hands of an ecclesiastical judge, who wished to put in information against the writer on the strength of this document. Now this judge was justly punished by his superior, because confession is so sacred that even that which is destined to constitute the confession should be wrapped in eternal silence. In accordance with this precedent, the following judgment reported in the Traité des Confesseurs was given by Roderic Acugno, a Catalonian native of Barcelona, who was condemned to death for homicide and owned his guilt, refused to confess when the hour of punishment arrived. However strongly pressed, he resisted, and so violently, giving no reason, that all were persuaded that his mind was unhinged by the fear of death. Saint Thomas of Villeneuve, Archbishop of Valencia, heard of his obstinacy. Valencia was the place where his sentence was given. The worthy prelate was so charitable as to try to persuade the criminal to make his confession, so as not to lose his soul as well as his body. Great was his surprise when he asked the reason of the refusal, to hear the doomed man declare that he hated confessors, because he had been condemned through the treachery of his own priest, who was the only person who knew about the murder. In confession, he had admitted his crime and said where the body was buried and all about it. His confessor had revealed it all, and he could not deny it, and so he had been condemned. He had only just learned, what he did not know at the time he confessed, that his confessor was the brother of the man he had killed, and that the desire for vengeance had prompted the bad priest to betray his confession. St. Thomas, hearing this, thought that this incident was of more importance than the trial, which concerned the life of only one person, whereas the honor of religion was at stake, with consequences infinitely more important. He felt he must verify this statement and summoned the confessor. When he had admitted the breach of faith, the judges were obliged to revoke their sentence and pardon the criminal, much to the gratification of the public mind. The confessor was adjudged a very severe penance, which St. Thomas modified because of his prompt avowal of his fault, and still more because he had given an opportunity for the public exhibition of that reverence which judges themselves are bound to pay to confessions. Second case. In 1579, an innkeeper in Toulouse killed with his own hand, unknown to the inmates of his house, a stranger who had come to lodge with him, and buried him secretly in the cellar. The wretch then suffered from remorse and confessed the crime with all its circumstances, telling his confessor where the body was buried. The relations of the dead man, after making all possible search to get news of him, at last proclaimed through the town a large reward to be given to anyone who would discover what had happened to him. The confessor, tempted by this bait, secretly gave word that they had only to search in the innkeeper's cellar and they would find the corpse. And they found it in the place indicated. The innkeeper was thrown into prison, was tortured, and confessed his crime. But afterwards he always maintained that his confessor was the only person who could have betrayed him. Then the Parliament, indignant with such means of finding out the truth, declared him innocent, failing other proof than what came through his confessor. The confessor was himself condemned to be hanged, and his body was burnt. So fully did the tribunal in its wisdom recognize the importance of securing the sanctity of a sacrament that is indispensable to salvation. Third case. An Armenian woman had inspired a violent passion in a young Turkish gentleman, but her prudence was long an obstacle to her lover's desires. At last he went beyond all bounds and threatened to kill both her and her husband if she refused to gratify him. Frightened by this threat, which she knew too well he would carry out, she feigned consent and gave the Turk a rendezvous at her house at an hour when she said her husband would be absent. But by arrangement the husband arrived, and although the Turk was armed with a saber and a pair of pistols, it so befell that they were fortunate enough to kill their enemy, whom they buried under their dwelling unknown to all the world. But some days after the event they went to confess to a priest of their nation and revealed every detail of the tragic story. This unworthy minister of the Lord supposed that in a Mohammedan country, where the laws of priesthood and functions of a confessor are either unknown or disapproved, no examination would be made into the source of his information, and that his evidence would have the same weight as any other accuser's. So he resolved to make a profit and gratify his own avarice. Several times he visited the husband and wife, always borrowing considerable sums and threatening to reveal their crime if they refused him. The first few times the poor creatures gave in to his exactions, but the moment came at last when, robbed of all their fortune, they were obliged to refuse the sum he demanded. Faithful to his threat, the priest, with a view to more reward, at once denounced them to the dead man's father. He, who had adored his son, went to the vizier, told him he had identified the murderers through their confessor, and asked for justice. But this denunciation had by no means the desired effect. The vizier, on the contrary, felt deep pity for the wretched Armenians and indignation against the priest who had betrayed them. He put the accuser into a room which adjoined the court, and sent for the Armenian bishop to ask what confession really was, and what punishment was deserved by a priest who betrayed it, and what was the fate of those whose crimes were made known in this fashion. The bishop replied that the secrets of confession are inviolable, that Christians burn the priest who reveals them and absolve those whom he accuses, because the avowal made by the guilty to the priest is proscribed by the Christian religion on pain of eternal damnation. The vizier, satisfied with the answer, took the bishop into another room and summoned the accused to declare all the circumstances. The poor wretches, half dead, fell at the vizier's feet. The woman spoke, explaining that the necessity of defending life and honor had driven them to take up arms to kill their enemy. She added that God alone had witnessed their crime, and it would still be unknown had not the law of the same God compelled them to confide it to the ear of one of his ministers for their forgiveness. Now the priest's insatiable avarice had ruined them first and then denounced them. The vizier made them go into a third room and ordered the treacherous priest to be confronted with the bishop, making him again rehearse the penalties incurred by those who betray confessions. Then, applying this to the guilty priest, he condemned him to be burnt alive in a public place, in anticipation, said he, of burning in hell, where he would assuredly receive the punishment of his infidelity and crimes. The sentence was executed without delay. In spite of the effect which the advocate intended to produce by these three cases, either the judges rejected them, or perhaps they thought the other evidence without the confession was enough. And it was soon clear to everyone, by the way the trial went forward, that the Marquise would be condemned. Indeed, before sentence was pronounced, on the morning of July 16th, 1676, she saw Monsieur Pierrot, doctor of the Sorbonne, come into a prison sent by the chief president. This worthy magistrate, foreseeing the issue, and feeling that one so guilty should not be left till the last moment, had sent the good priest. The latter, although he had objected that the conciergerie had its own two chaplains, and added that he was too feeble to undertake such a task, being unable even to see another man bled without feeling ill, accepted the painful mission. The president, having so strongly urged it, on the ground that in this case he needed a man who could be entirely trusted. The president, in fact, declared that, accustomed as he was to dealing with criminals, the strength of the Marquise amazed him. The day before he summoned Monsieur Perrault, he had worked at the trial from morning to night, and for 13 hours the accused had been confronted with Briancourt, one of the chief witnesses against her. On that very day there had been 5 hours more, and she had borne it all, showing as much respect toward her judges as haughtiness toward the witnesses, reproaching him as a miserable valet, given to drink, and protesting that as he had been dismissed for his misdemeanors, his testimony against her ought to go for nothing. So the chief president felt no hope of breaking her inflexible spirit, except by the agency of a minister of religion. For it was not enough to put her to death. The poisons must perish with her, or else society would gain nothing. The doctor Perrault came to the Marquise with a letter from her sister, who, as we know, was a nun bearing the name of Sister Marie at the convent Saint Jacques. Her letter exhorted the Marquise in the most touching and affectionate terms to place her confidence in the good priest and look upon him not only as a helper but as a friend. When Monsieur Perrault came before the Marquise, she had just left the dock, where she had been for 3 hours without confessing anything, or seeming in the least touched by what the president said, though he, after acting the part of judge, addressed her simply as a Christian, and showing her what her deplorable position was, appearing now for the last time before men and destined so soon to appear before God, spoke to her such moving words that he broke down himself, and the oldest and most obdurate judges present wept when they heard him. When the Marquise perceived the doctor, suspecting that her trial was leading to her death, she approached him, saying,
"You have come, sir, because—"
But Father Chavigny, who was with Monsieur Perrault, interrupted her, saying,
"Madame, we will begin with a prayer."
They all fell on their knees, invoking the Holy Spirit. Then the Marquise asked them to add a prayer to the Virgin, And this prayer finished, she went up to the doctor and, beginning afresh, said,
"Sir, no doubt the president has sent you to give me consolation. With you I am to pass the little life I have left. I have long been eager to see you."
"Madame," the doctor replied,
"I come to render you any spiritual office that I can. I only wish it were on another occasion."
"We must have resolution, sir," said she, smiling, "for all things."
Then turning to Father Chevigny, she said,
"My father, I am very grateful to you for bringing the doctor here, and for all the other visits you have been willing to pay me. Pray to God for me, I entreat you. Henceforth I shall speak with no one but the doctor, for with him I must speak of things that can only be discussed tête-à-tête. Farewell, then, my father. God will reward you for the attention you have been willing to bestow upon me."
With these words, the father retired, leaving the marquise alone with the doctor and the two men and one woman always in attendance on her. They were in a large room in the Montgomery Tower, extending throughout its whole length. There was at the end of the room a bed with gray curtains for the lady and a folding bed for the custodian. It is said to have been the same room where the poet Theophile was once shut up, and near the door there were still verses in his well-known style, written by his hand. As soon as the two men and the woman saw for what the doctor had come, they retired to the end of the room, leaving the marquise free to ask for and receive the consolations brought her by the man of God. Then the two sat at a table side by side. The marquise thought she was already condemned and began to speak on that assumption. But the doctor told her that sentence was not yet given, and he did not know precisely when it would be, still less what it would be. But at these words the marquise interrupted him.
"Sir," said she, "I am not troubled about the future. If my sentence is not given yet, it soon will be. I expect the news this morning, and I know it will be death. The only grace I look for from the president is a delay between the sentence and its execution. For if I were executed today, I should have very little time to prepare, and I feel I have need for more."
The doctor did not expect such words, so he was overjoyed to learn what she felt. In addition to what the president had said, he had heard from Father Chevigny that he had told her the Sunday before that it was very unlikely she would escape death. And indeed, so far as one could judge by reports in the town, it was a foregone conclusion. When he said so, at first she had appeared stunned, and said with an air of great terror,
"Father, I must die?"
And when he tried to speak words of consolation, she had risen and shaken her head, proudly replying,
"No, no, Father, there is no need to encourage me. I will play my part, and that at once. I shall know how to die like a woman of spirit."
Then the father had told her that we cannot prepare for death so quickly and so easily, and that we have to be in readiness for a long time, not to be taken by surprise, and she had replied that she needed but a quarter of an hour to confess in, and one moment to die. So the doctor was very glad to find that between Sunday and Thursday her feelings had changed so much.
"Yes," said she, "the more I reflect, the more I feel that one day would not be enough to prepare myself for God's tribunal, to be judged by him after men have judged me."
"Madame," replied the doctor, "I do not know what or when your sentence will be, but should it be death, and given today, I must venture to promise you that it will not be carried out before tomorrow. But although death is as yet uncertain, I think it well that you should be prepared for any event."
"Oh, my death is quite certain," said she, "and I must not give way to useless hopes. I must repose in you the great secrets of my whole life. But, Father, before this opening of my heart, let me hear from your lips the opinion you have formed of me, and what you think, in my present state, I ought to do."
"You perceive my plan," said the doctor, "and you anticipate what I was about to say. Before entering into the secrets of your conscience, before opening the discussion of your affairs with God, I am ready, madame, to give you certain definite rules. I do not yet know whether you are guilty at all, and I suspend my judgment as to all the crimes you are accused of, since of them I can learn nothing except through your confession. Thus, it is my duty still to doubt your guilt. But I cannot be ignorant of what you are accused of, this of a public matter, and has reached my ears, for as you may imagine, madame, your affairs have made a great stir, and there are few people who know nothing about them.
Yes, said she, smiling. I know there has been a great deal of talk, and I am in every man's mouth.
Then, replied the doctor, the crime you are accused of is poisoning. If you are guilty as is believed, you cannot hope that God will pardon you unless you make known to your judges what the poison is, what is its composition, and what its antidote, also the names of your accomplices. Madame, we must lay hands on all these evildoers without exception, for if you spared them, they would be able to make use of your poison, and you would then be guilty of all the murders committed by them after your death. Because you did not give them over to the judges during your life, thus one might say you survive yourself, for your crime survives you. You know, madame, that a sin in the moment of death is never pardoned, and that to get remission for your crimes, if crimes you have, they must die when you die. For if you slay them not, be very sure they will slay you.
Yes, I am sure of that, replied the marquise after a moment of silent thought. And though I will not admit that I am guilty, I promise, if I am guilty, to weigh your words. But one question, sir, and pray take heed that an answer is necessary. Is there not a crime in this world that is beyond pardon? Are not some people guilty of sins so terrible and so numerous that the church dares not pardon them? And if God, in his justice, takes account of them, he cannot for all his mercy pardon them? See, I begin with this question because, if I am to have no hope, it is needless for me to confess.
I wish to think, madame, replied the doctor, in spite of himself, half frightened at the marquise, that this, your first question, is only put by way of a general thesis and has nothing to do with your own state. I shall answer the question without any personal application. No, madame, in this life, there are no unpardonable sinners, terrible and numerous howsoever their sins may be. This is an article of faith, and without holding it, you could not die a good Catholic. Some doctors, it is true, have before now maintained the contrary, but they have been condemned as heretics. Only despair and final impenitence are unpardonable, and they are not sins of our life, but in our death.
Sir, replied the marquise, God has given me grace to be convinced by what you say, and I believe he will pardon all sins, that he has often exercised this power. Now, all my trouble is that he may not deign to grant all his goodness to one so wretched as I am, a creature so unworthy of the favors already bestowed on her.
The doctor reassured her as best he could, and began to examine her attentively as they conversed together.
She was, he said, a woman naturally courageous and fearless, naturally gentle and good, not easily excited, clever and penetrating, seeing things very clearly in her mind, and expressing herself well and in few but careful words, easily finding a way out of a difficulty, and choosing her line of conduct in the most embarrassing circumstances, light-minded and fickle, unstable, paying no attention if the same thing were said several times over. For this reason, continued the doctor, I was obliged to alter what I had to say from time to time, keeping her but a short time on one subject, to which, however, I would return later, giving the matter a new appearance and disguising it a little. She spoke little and well, with no sign of learning and no affectation, always mistress of herself, always composed and saying just what she intended to say. No one would have supposed from her face or from her conversation that she was so wicked as she must have been, judging by her public avowal of the parricide. It is surprising, therefore, and one must bow down before the judgment of God when he leaves mankind to himself, that a mind evidently of some grandeur, professing fearlessness in the most untoward and unexpected events, an unmovable firmness and a resolution to await and endure death if so it must be, should yet be so criminal as she was proved to be by the parricide to which she confessed before her judges. She had nothing in her face that would indicate such evil. She had very abundant chestnut hair, a rounded, well-shaped face, blue eyes, very pretty and gentle, extraordinarily white skin, good nose, and no disagreeable feature. Still, there was nothing unusually attractive in the face. Already she was a little wrinkled and looked older than her age. Something made me ask at our first interview how old she was.
"Monsieur,"
she said,
"if I were to live till St. Madeleine's Day, I should be 46. On her day I came into the world, and I bear her name. I was christened Marie Madeleine, but near to the day as we are now, I shall not live so long. I must end today, or at least tomorrow, and it will be a favor to give me the one day. For this kindness, I rely on your word."
Anyone would have thought she was quite 48, though her face, as a rule, looked so gentle. Whenever an unhappy thought crossed her mind, she showed it by a contortion that frightened one at first, and from time to time I saw her face twitching with anger, scorn, ill will. I forgot to say that she was very little and thin. Such is roughly given a description of her body and mind, which I very soon came to know, taking pains from the first to observe her, so as to lose no time in acting on what I discovered.
As she was giving a first brief sketch of her life to her confessor, the Marquise remembered that he had not yet said Mass, and reminded him herself that it was time to do so, pointing out to him the chapel of the Conciergerie. She begged him to say a Mass for her and in honor of Our Lady, so that she might gain the intercession of the Virgin at the throne of God. The Virgin she had always taken for her patron saint, and in the midst of her crimes and disorderly life, had never ceased in her peculiar devotion. As she could not go with the priest, she promised to be with him at least in the spirit. He left her at 10:30 in the morning, and after 4 hours spent alone together, she had been induced by his piety and gentleness to make confessions that could not be wrung from her by the threats of the judges or the fear of the question. The holy and devout priest said his Mass, praying the Lord's help for confessor and penitent alike. After Mass, as he returned, he learned from a librarian called Sinet, at the porter's lodge, as he was taking a glass of wine, that judgment had been given, and that Madame de Brinvilliers was to have her hand cut off. This severity, as a fact, there was a mitigation of this sentence, made him feel yet more interest in his penitent, and he hastened back to her side. End of section 3.